Good evening, and welcome to Full Moon Matinee. I'm your host, the detective, bringing you the finest crime dramas and film noir from the golden age of Hollywood. Tonight's picture is from 1958, The Case Against Brooklyn, starring Darren McGavin, Maggie Hayes, and Warren Stevens. And an interesting little story to this, you'll see when the film starts rolling the opening credits, you'll see that it states that the screenplay was written by Raymond T. Marcus. That was really an alias that was used by Bernard Gordon. He actually co-wrote the screenplay with Julian Zimmet. The two of them were blacklisted back during the McCarthy-era Red Scare, so, of course, they couldn't use their real names. Now, the picture here, it's directed by Paul Wendkost, and its director of photography is Fred Jackman. And what we have here is some stellar cinematography, especially in the night scenes in the city. And those of you who have been following for some time, you know I'm a big fan of John Alton, you know, one of the great noir cinematographers for this era. Well, these two guys, they're certainly running him neck and neck with this picture. And of course, in various scenes, we also have those classic voiceovers in the police procedural style. Now, the picture here, it's about a recently graduated rookie cop who's recruited to fight police corruption in a Brooklyn precinct, and he does so by infiltrating a mob-controlled gambling network. To do so, he has to get close to a recent widow whose late husband was in debt to the mob. In danger and flames when the mob finds out he's a cop. So, from 1958, The Case Against Brooklyn. Let's roll the picture.
I know.
5,800, Gus.
I've been on the hook before.
Out of my hands now. You gotta pay up today.
Now, Mr. Finelli, tell me how.
You got your headaches, I got mine. You know about my heart condition.
Where can I dig up that kind of dough?
You own a garage, a couple of produce trucks. You got a good business.
I owe 4 months' rent. I owe back wages. I'm in hock.
Your wife drives a nice car.
I can't. That's hers.
What's the matter? You afraid she won't put out anymore?
The bank owns the car.
You spend a lot on that chick, Gus. Maybe you can't afford it now.
What do you want? I should cash in my wife with you?
With my heart? Look, you clean up these IOUs today. Otherwise, I gotta send around to collect.
Mr. Fidelli, please. One more week.
What'll it be then?
Hustling laundry, eh, Rudy?
This kind of wash, I don't mind hustling.
No ambition. That's what happens when you grow up in the slums.
Yeah. If I'd only had the advantages other kids had, might have been something big. School teacher, even. See you in night school.
Yeah.
It's getting heavier.
So where's the payoff?
Hey, Tommy, is the ratio of the net profits to the gross keep pace with the standing overhead percentage-wise?
I'll explain it to you someday.
Don't bother. I don't even understand the question.
Grease for the wheels of justice.
Grease? And I thought it was shirts. Nice and clean now, Sergeant.
Now, to try one of these steam baths sometimes, Rudy, takes out all the poison.
You've been on the take 6 years now. You ought to be able to afford your own bathtub.
I don't get it all, Rudy. Just a little slice off the bottom.
Now, you'll make captain someday, Sergeant. Then you can split the payola your own way.
Thank you.
people shouldn't welch.
You can't beat it out of me. It won't do no good.
Okay, that's enough. Beat it.
Gus!
Not a word out of you.
Gus, come on. We'll be late for the show.
Gus! What happened?
I saw somebody run out.
Gus, are you all right? What happened to you? Who did it? What did they want?
It's nothing. I'm all right.
You're all right.
No, I know. I can take care of myself.
Yes, you look like it. I'm going to call a doctor.
Oh, my shit.
I'm sorry, Lou. I'm sorry.
God! Gus, please let me in. Gus, please let me in. Gus, let me help.
It'll be okay. Why don't you go on home? Remember, sucker, $5,800. We'll be back tomorrow.
Rogers, I want you to see this.
This is the big, big headline in Brooklyn today. And here with us is Ed Reed, one of the enterprising reporters who fearlessly broke this story. Ed, suppose you tell us about it in your own words.
Well, George, I've been working on this story for 6 weeks now. And I know there are between 20 and 30 horse rooms operating in Brooklyn. I've been in half a dozen of them myself.
Now, a horse room is where you place bets on the races. Now, do you consider such betting evil or immoral?
Well, not the betting, George, but the fact that a huge syndicate is operating with police protection.
How do you know this police protection?
The whole operation is too big, too open, too brazen. If I could find out about it, so could the police. And this is the crux of the matter. Somewhere in this town, there's a man more powerful than the mayor, the district attorney, the chief of police. He's more powerful because he has the police in his pay. If the police will give protection to the gamblers, they'll sell it to the thieves and murderers, too. I have reason to believe they already have.
That's a very serious charge. Any facts to back it up?
Some citizens have been beaten up by these bookies, but they're afraid to complain to the police. Were all too frequently in the pay of the syndicate. When the law is suspended for a price, and truth and justice can be peddled on the marketplace, then every citizen's in danger. And the law belongs to the highest bidder.
Well, Rogers, you're Deputy Commissioner of Police Personnel. You recommend we sue them for slander?
Now, look, Norris, I have over 7,000 men under me. You've got to expect a few rotten apples, or more than a few. I'm talking about a payoff that runs into millions of dollars. And that has to include lieutenants and captains. As far as I know, a few inspectors.
Well, the police commissioner agrees. I have a plan here for a wholesale shift in personnel involving every precinct in the borough.
No one ever got rid of rotten apples by just shifting them around in the barrel. The men on the take will just start operating in their new precinct, as we know they always do.
Inside of a week, the syndicate will be right back in business again.
From past experience, we know that what we need is some honest cops to catch a few crooked ones. A group we can be dead certain has not been corrupted. I think I know where to find them.
Who's going to deliver them, the stork?
It may be closer to the truth than you think. The police academy is graduating 40 rookies the day after tomorrow. 40 bright, ambitious young men who don't think honesty is a dirty word. I want them assigned to me, personally, and secretly.
In order to maintain secrecy, I established temporary quarters in a downtown office building and proceeded to assign the rookies to various areas and different jobs.
Sit down, Harris.
Thank you, sir.
The Heller tells me you did some intelligence work in the Marines.
Yes, sir, in Japan.
I think you're the man for this assignment. This is the 65th precinct. It's running wide open. Closed down a horse room one day, and the next day is operating a block away. Sometimes I think the bookies run faster than the horses. We want you to go in there and find out everything you can about the operation.
Just going cold, sir?
Everything we know is in this file. Study it. Oh. This is a picture of Lil Palumbo. We have a hunch she's a good lead. Her husband was in deep to the bookies. He turned up dead a few days ago.
An accident, maybe?
Well, we questioned her, but all we got back were echoes. She was too scared to talk. Establish yourself in the neighborhood. This is a complete file on the widow. I want you to get acquainted with her. Get her to talk. We don't expect any one man to come up with all the answers. But in the end, we want to know who's collecting the money, who's delivering it, and who's getting paid off. And finally, who's running the whole syndicate for Brooklyn.
Oh, yes, I understand, sir.
Need somebody to work with you. Anyone you'd prefer?
Yes, Johnson? Johnson? All right, he's yours. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Churn, you're a fine-looking policeman.
Yeah.
What's the matter, Pete?
Oh, honey, I guess it's just getting back into uniform again. Sergeant Peter Harris, U.S. Marine Corps. Now, Private Pete Harris, New York Police Department. Onwards and upwards.
Like starting all over again, isn't it?
Yeah, except that I'm 10 years older.
10 years handsomer. Mm. I like older men.
No.
It's gonna work out, Pete. I know it. Mm.
Must be Jess. You got enough for dinner?
Ever since you do homework together, I shop for three.
All right.
Hi,
Mother. Posies. I picked them in Prospect Park.
That's against the law.
You're speaking on officer, ma'am. I am the law.
Oh, love.
Thank you.
Put him in water.
Honey, while you're at it, would you put a little scotch in water, please?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, officer, you're not in uniform.
Yeah.
Happy? Well, aren't we snazzy, huh? What a doll. A real doll.
Yeah, all right. Don't overdo it, huh?
Very cute. Now you can put it back in mothballs.
Why?
Why? The uniforms are pounding a beat, honey. We're plain clothes.
Hey, Jess.
Like badge 540 here. Hey, Pete, I want you to watch this guy. Watch him closely. See how he does it. You may learn something.
What's he talking about?
Oh, it's nothing, honey. It's our first assignment. It's plain clothes.
Didn't you tell her how we're going to lower the boom on the bookie syndicate?
Jess, will you shut up? This is supposed to be a secret investigation.
Hey, we can tell her.
Pete rented an apartment on 29th Avenue near the Palumbo Garage. A few of the younger men who could pass for students were ordered to enroll at different colleges, known hotbeds of gambling. Others got jobs as truck drivers, telephone linemen, and waiters. Some of the rookies were given a course in wiretapping procedure.
Hi, Pappy. Hey. This ain't a bad-looking joint. We could throw a little party in this place. All the night's work, you understand what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I just may do that, but... You're not invited.
Somebody. Widow, huh? Not a bad-looking dame.
I don't care what she looks like. She's gonna appeal to me.
You're really going on a make, huh?
You know a better way to get a dame to talk?
No. Seriously, Pete. You wouldn't go that far, would you?
Seriously? Yeah, I'd go that far.
Badge 540. New York's finest.
You heard what the man said about opportunity? Well, I'm going to be at the head of that line. Look, you look that file over. In about 10 minutes, you go down to the corner bar. I'll see you there. If I get a lead on anything, follow me out of there and look the place over from the outside. Well, I'm off to the garage and the start of a beautiful friendship. Remember, when you see me, you don't know me.
Harris's story was that he had just returned to Brooklyn after living in California. He knew Lil Palumbo was now running her late husband's garage.
Park here by the month?
$25. One wash job a week, no pickups, no deliveries.
Fine. I just moved into the neighborhood. Is there a shoe repair around here?
Right down the block, there's a shoe repair, delicatessen bar, candy store, and a fortune teller.
Thanks. If I need anything else, unless a fortune teller.
That'll be $25 in advance.
Fine.
Hey, the horse named Uncle Barney looks good in the fourth at Hollywood Park. Knowingly a bet.
Why gamble? Save your money for the better things in life. Like whiskey.
Yeah. I don't know. Odds are 20 to 1. Looks good to me.
Knowingly a bet. Tell you what.
Yeah.
There's a hack stand down the street.
Yeah.
Get a cabbie to take you out to LaGuardia. Hop on a plane. And you'll be in California in time for the race.
Oh, Mervin, if I was single, I'd marry you.
Mm-hmm.
You doll.
Hi, folks. What do you have?
Beer.
Two beers, draft.
Two beers, draft? Come on up.
I heard about your husband. It's too bad. It must have happened right after he took that shellacking.
Make a donation in his name.
I'm just trying to put you wise.
What?
Well, you've been around as long as I have. You know a couple of things. Gus had insurance, didn't he?
So?
So play it smart. In suicide, they don't pay double indemnity.
Who said anything about double indemnity or suicide?
Everybody carries double indemnity. Now, look. Those insurance dicks find out about that strong-arm treatment, they're going to snoop around for 5 years to prove that
Gus was in trouble, and then he drove himself off the road.
Hey, all of a sudden, you're so interested in my welfare.
I know it's none of my business, but... I know you're alone now, and I'm kind of alone, I thought.
So, we orphans have to kind of take care of each other, huh? Ah, the gentleman from California.
Hi. Can I buy you a drink?
I already have one, but you can give me your car keys. You took them with you, and your car's blocking traffic in my garage.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Thanks. Why don't you sit down?
All right.
I thought everybody was moving the other way. How come you come from the coast here?
Business.
Oh, any special kind?
Rudy's a business expert. He drives a laundry truck. Your business, my business, his business.
I don't mind. I had a piece of luck. An aunt left me a couple of houses on the side of Atlantic Avenue. I grew up around there.
Around here?
Yeah. Yeah, I've been looking at you over my shoulder up here. Aren't you Lil Alexander?
I was.
P.S. 47, sixth grade, Miss Lederman's class, right? Mm. Huh?
I don't believe it. Well, I don't remember you.
Well, I sure remember you. We were both 12 years old. I was looking at you, but you were looking at those big guys at 14.
Oh, that's me, all right. I'm always looking at them.
The trouble with me is I never got past the fifth grade. Yeah, well, I've got some business. I'll see you around. And remember, just say the word.
Sure, Rudy. Thanks. Well, I guess I better get back, too. The grease monkeys can get a break.
Hey, wait a minute. Like your keys.
Oh, I almost forgot.
I don't even know your name. Is it still the same?
Mrs. Palumbo. Well, it was. I guess it still is. My husband's dead.
Oh.
Just Lil.
Give me another beer, huh?
Okay. So you want the PS-47, huh?
That's right.
It isn't too late. You can make that bet.
Yeah?
Back at a barbershop, around the corner.
Yeah?
Tell him Mervin the cheerful loser sent you. And while you're there, give my love to my wristwatch.
Yeah. For you, I feel lucky. One and a half.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah? What do you
right
want?
Here.
I got $200 bucks? Right.
Yeah, all right. Okay. Tender win on Uncle Barney.
In the stretch, it's Coffee Clutch, Big Emma, Coral D, and King Jonas. They're coming down to the line of finish. It's Coffee Clutch by length and a half, Big Emma, Carol D, and King Jonas.
I ain't seen you around.
I just moved into the neighborhood.
First National, I got a check for $10 on Pete Harris. Is it good?
For $10, you got a check with Dun and Bradstreet?
You'd be surprised at things horse players will try.
And now the changes for the third race. Scratch Molly Q. Jockey substitution. Mr. McCoy will be ridden
Come
by...
Come on, I want to get on this
Jim
race.
Huh?
I'm taking my watch.
Take his bet. If you don't mind, I'll hold on for the bank. They shouldn't be disappointed. I didn't wait.
Sarah, Mr. McCoy moving up. Uncle Bonnie and poor Pam on the outside. They're coming out of the line of finish, and it's Uncle Barney by a nose, Molly Q by a length and a half, Mr. McCoy by a length, followed by...
Uncle Barney on the nose.
Check's good. Pay the man.
Thank you.
knock Joe at Hollywood Park tomorrow. I think we ought to cover ourselves and spread some of it around a bit.
Good idea, Finelli. Will do.
Sorry, officer. Like a jerk, I locked myself out.
You live around here?
Yeah, that's right. A couple of blocks over, 251 Anthony Place.
See your registration.
Sure.
What was the take today?
We cleared 30 G's.
Good, good, Finelli.
Okay?
You better get yourself some new plates. Those out-of-towners are only good for 30 days.
Thanks. Good night, officer.
Rooms were located. Motion pictures, photographs, tape recordings were made. A mountain of evidence was collected, but none of this led beyond the small fry, the petty hirelings of the syndicate. The problem remained, how to find the higher-ups and the police who were selling protection.
Rogers, I think
now is the time to order the complete shift of police personnel. A real shakeup.
The word had be passed around, new contacts made, protection arranged for. This business is too lucrative to stop even for one day.
Oh, I agree. A lot of the reorganization would be done on the phone, fast. Now we're in a position to pick it up.
Heat's on even in here.
Well, at least this heat can't send a man to Flatbush. Rudy, that's Sergeant Bonnie. He's your new contact.
You're gonna like our laundry service, Sergeant.
You better take a good gander so you don't make any mistakes.
I'll recognize you. You got that cop look.
What's that?
Like you never missed a meal in your life. Finelli said there was this guy hanging around the alley. When he spotted Finelli, he took off fast.
Was he wearing sneakers?
Sneakers or floor shines, who cares?
If he was wearing sneakers, probably he's the second story man casing the joint for a heist.
Sure, what else? Any cheap crook thinks when he knocks off a bookie, we'll be scared to go to the cops.
I'll keep an eye open. Any garnet gets ideas. He'll be telling it to the coroner.
That's right, Sergeant. Do your duty.
Pete, I'm worried. I've been worried ever since Fat Boy spotted me in that alley.
You think Finelli caught on?
I don't know. Could be. Look, Pete, let's stay clear for a while.
Nope. If we do that, we'll never get anything done. We've got to make that pass tonight.
Look, Pete, why take a chance? Why blow the whole thing?
You feel that way about it? I'll pick up the tape myself. You can sit this one out.
Come on, how? You know I wouldn't feel right about that.
I can't force you, Jess.
Okay. Okay, you win. What time? Where do we meet?
Make it 2 a.m., huh? I got a date with Lil tonight. She told me Gus was in hock to the bookies. Now I want to get the blow-by-blow on the why and the how he died.
What happens if you strike out? Weekend in Atlantic City, huh? You could really find out everything she knows.
Salads, two coffees, and...
two aspirin.
Oh?
It's just nerves. Doctor said I should have had kids, but I kept putting it off. Why? And now I'll tell you about my operation. It's your turn. You talk.
Well, what do you want to know?
I don't think you're really the kind of guy you pretend to be. You know, this easy come, easy go, around the world in a balloon type. I don't think that's your type at all.
No? What is my type?
I think you're a serious Joe. See something you want, you go after it.
Is that bad?
I like the serious type. The do-it-for-kicks guys never sold me.
Hey, can I join the party?
Well, Mr. Harris invited me out, Rudy. Did you invite Rudy, too?
No.
He says you're not invited.
We'll be alone, huh? Okay.
Pretty sensitive type, huh? One date and he's ready to move in and play house.
Did you know him from before?
I met him the night Gus was beat up.
Oh, yeah. Why was your husband beat up? Oh,
bookies, I guess. He owed him a mint.
Did Gus kill himself?
You don't by any chance have a connection to an insurance company.
Hmm?
Oh, forget it. Now tell me about yourself.
Well, come on, we better eat before we catch that show, huh?
Thanks, Pete. I enjoyed the show very much.
How about making me a cup of coffee?
I don't think I'd better. Besides, I don't have any coffee.
How about tea? Hot water?
That's what I'm afraid of getting into. There's an actor that parks his car in the garage. He gave me two tickets for a play next Wednesday night.
All right. I'll pick you up about 7 o'clock.
Circle the block once. That'll give you plenty of time.
Well, Pete.
You want to drive? I'll do it myself.
Take care of yourself.
Wait a minute. It's a cop.
Be in the alley.
I got a tip. Somebody was trying to break into the barbershop.
Who tipped you?
An informer.
Must have been Finelli.
I never heard of Finelli. I tell you, I didn't know Jess Johnson was a cop. Look, Mr. Norris, you better take me to a doctor.
Come on, Finelli. Tell us what you're doing.
Come on, will you? Come on, will you? Do you like his way better?
Listen, he won't be an officer for very long, and neither will you if you try that again.
I want you to hear what's on this tape recorder.
Play it so he can hear. Listen, Bonnie.
That DA thinks shuffling around a bunch of flat feet will drive us out of business. He'd better get himself a new crystal ball.
Just because the DA's driving a three-year-old car is no reason why we should. What's the orders?
Business as usual. Deliver the bundle on the first, same as always. New man's name is Bonnie. Got it?
Bonnie. Okay. I'll see he's taken care of.
You want to hear it again, Bonnie? So you didn't know he was a cop? Did you know what was on that tape?
How could I know?
Who else was in on the take? And who's the boss? You want to know how it's going to sound in court when I try you for murder? You want to know what the jury's going to hear? You think you'll convince them you were just doing a job? Shooting a prowler! We're booking for conspiracy and first-degree murder. Stay here while I call the police commissioner.
Sit down.
I want some water.
I'll get it for you. Just getting him a drink of water.
You better go down there. You stay here.
Hello again. Oh. Oh, I'm gonna have to reload. But boy, I'll tell you, that fight scene in the alley there where Jess gets shot, now that was some fantastic photography, let me tell you. And then we had that scene there in the gym, you know, the finished steam baths. There they were smoking in the locker room. You know, there was even a cigarette machine there in the locker room. You wouldn't find that in a gym today. Hell, you wouldn't find it in a bar. Now, an interesting piece of trivia here with tonight's picture. The film footage of the truck crash, you know, there where Gus commits suicide, that film footage was borrowed from 1949's Thieves' Highway. It's the same clip. So if you've seen that picture and watching tonight's here, if it looks familiar, well, it is. Now, Maggie Hayes, she's the one playing Lil Palumbo here. She was born in Baltimore, Maryland, and her real name is Florette Ottenheimer. Now, she began her acting and modeling career under the name Dana Dale, but soon changed it to Dana Edwards, and eventually settled on Margaret Hayes. Though in many films, and tonight's was one of them, in the film credits, it was often shortened to Maggie. Now, far and away, her best remembered film was 1955's Blackboard Jungle. She was in that with Glenn Ford and Anne Francis, and it also featured Sidney Poitier. Now, some of her other notables, she was in 1941's Sullivan's Travels. She was in that with Joel McRae and Veronica Lake. 1942's The Glass Key with Brian Donlevy and again Veronica Lake. So she's worked with her twice. 1959's Good Day for a Hanging. Now that was a Western, and she starred in that opposite Fred McMurray. And probably also 1959's The Beat Generation. She was in that with Steve Cochran and Mamie Van Doren. So let's get back to the case against Brooklyn.
What are you doing?
I gotta spend more time in the other apartment.
Now?
Now? Plumber woman gave me an important lead. She told me her husband was beat up by the bookie just before he was killed. I got a plan. I'm gonna find out who's behind all that.
You might wind up killed too, like Jess.
Jess's death was an accident. Couldn't be helped.
Do you have to go through with this?
Yeah, I gotta go through with it, okay? No, honey, no, I could tell him that I'm quitting because my little wife is afraid.
I am afraid. Not just because of the danger.
Well, then what is it?
It's what's happening to you. Nothing else matters anymore. Is the job so important?
Yeah, it's important to me. Dick Cheney, I gotta make it. Don't you understand that? I'll pass Finelli a big check and then close out my account at the bank. He'll send his collectors around and I'll squawk to the cops. See, that way we'll get a line on the muscle men and maybe on the police at the same time, right?
If you live to tell us about it.
I can take care of myself. I'll be waiting for him.
Norris won't go for it, Hurt.
Yeah? Okay, which is an idea. What's my next move?
We raided the room behind the barbershop. It was empty. They were tipped off. You find the new horse room, keep on betting. I'll assign another man to work with you and tap their new lines.
Harris found out from the corner shoeshine boy that Finelli had moved his horse room behind Tony's bar. There he deliberately passed a bad check for $300.
Yeah? Oh, Lil, hello.
I was calling about tonight. I haven't seen you around in so long. I thought maybe you'd forgotten.
The show? No, I didn't forget. It's just that...
Well, I've been busy. You know, problems.
Oh, well, maybe I can help you with them.
Now listen, you take that understanding note out of your voice, or I'll be crying on your shoulder.
Maybe I'd like that. Never tried the Girl Scout bit.
Pick you up about 7 o'clock.
7 will be fine. And I'll wear my merit badges.
Bye.
You're making a big mistake, buddy.
Get over there. Up against the candle. Come on, move!
You're kind of cute, though.
Come on, put your feet on.
Closing up that bank account. Didn't you think we'd notice?
Who sent you here? Finale or the guy who gives him his orders?
What's the difference?
Police Department, 65th Precinct.
Get smart, buddy. Take a black eye now instead of a black box later.
Hello, my name's Harris. Now get this. Apartment 3C, 251 Anthony Place. I got a couple of goons here sent up by the bookies to work me over. Look, there are going to be two dead muscle men if you don't get over here fast. Officer, what's your name? Who am I speaking to? Hello?
Named Harris?
Says Bucky's are giving him some trouble.
Just plain drunk.
Please try Evergreen 40598. Yes, I've been trying them for about a half hour and the line seems to be busy. Would you check it for me?
I'm sorry, that line is out of order. I'll report it for you.
Thank you. Pete?
try to reach you for now.
You said you'd be home for dinner.
We have a date tonight with Neil.
Hello. Who do you want?
Pete Harris. Is this Evergreen 40598?
Is this Evergreen 40598?
You have the wrong number.
Don't tell me you're his sister.
I happen to have a date with him.
Well, he's in the pokey. Dearie?
What happened?
He was exchanging compound fractures with a couple of gorillas. I've had fights in my apartment before, but never one like this.
Oh.
Not even among the married people. You see, he's in jail. Tell him to stay there. I ain't running no Madison Square Garden.
He wants to see you. His name is Harris.
Yeah, I remember. All right, send him in. I'll handle it.
Take him in. All right, don't get pushed. Look, Captain, I like to get pushed around, see?
All right, all right. What's this all about?
I owe the bookies a what? These ladies had a couple of strong arms over to collect. I call the cops, and who gets pinched? Me. Look, I just want to get one thing straight, Captain. Who gets protection around here, me or the bookies?
Did you see anything to back up this story?
No, sir. Just plain drunk.
Yeah, I can smell it from here.
Look, I'm not drunk.
Let him sleep it off. See how he feels about it in the morning.
Look, Captain, there's a horse from on B Street. The boss's name's Finale. Look, I'm not drunk!
Does Pete Harris live here?
My husband isn't home now.
Well, my name is Palumbo. Pete parks his car in my husband's garage. There's been a fight, and...
What happened?
Well, the cops took Pete in, and we think you better call a lawyer.
Oh, sure. I'll call right away.
Well, bye.
Goodbye, and thank your husband for me, too.
Sure. Sure.
District Attorney Norris, please. This is Mrs. Pete Harris. No, it's personal. Ask him to call me. It's urgent.
Because it's all a bunch of lies. That's the difference. Bunch of lies.
Well, there's one thing that's no lie, Lil. Plenty of loot.
What about your wife and kids? They gonna come along too?
I got no wife and kids.
How's a girl to know?
What's with this wife and kids routine?
You know that Pete Harris, huh?
Yeah.
You think he's single, huh?
I don't
know. Yeah, you think he lives around here, huh? Well, he doesn't live around here. He lives at 733... Stanford and the Hobart Apartments. I was over there tonight and he's married and he's got a pretty wife. And the whole time he's around here giving me a run.
I don't get it. What's his racket?
I don't know. Beats me. Maybe he's queer for widows who run garages. Oh, I've had it. I'm going home. Give me my shoe.
Oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute. You can't walk. I'll drive you.
Oh, no, you don't. Thanks just the same, but I know that old bit. You drive me home, the next thing I know, you'll want to come upstairs for a cup of coffee, and the next thing I know, I'll be frying your eggs in the morning and washing your shirt. No thanks, Rudy. Good night.
Pete Harris. We goofed, Captain. He's a copper.
Hello?
Okay, I'll try the phone.
Henry's Delicatessen?
You have the wrong number.
Sorry.
Is everything okay?
Yeah.
Cops, we're all set. I can spring Harris now.
Hey, taxi!
Oh, Pete. Oh, Faye! What did they do?
Oh, honey, forget it. You should see the other guy.
Get him.
Happened. The DA wanted... I've got it.
I'll get a compress.
District Attorney's Office.
Hello, this is Pete Harris. Can I reach Mr. Norris?
Hello, Harris. This is Heller. Where are you?
I'm home.
I just sent a lawyer down to get you out. Get me out. How'd you know I was in?
I told him. Lil Palumbo was here.
Lil Palumbo?
You're going to have a lot of explaining to do, Harris.
Listen. It worked out fine. I got plenty on the boys in the 65th.
I'll try to reach Norris and call you back.
Yeah, okay. You don't suppose he wants to tell a DA on us, do you?
How did Lil Palumbo get here?
I don't know. She was worried about you. Really worried.
I had a date with Lil for tonight.
Just how far were you prepared to go with her?
Mm-hmm. Oh, honey, now wait a minute. That's probably Norris. I'll get him.
Yeah, hello.
This line is temporarily out of order. Please excuse the ring. This is a recording.
Of all times with a phone to go out of order.
Operator.
Operator, there's something wrong with my line.
Call the service department, please. 811.
Service department.
Operator, there's something wrong with this line.
Sorry, the day crew handles that.
Well, if there's an emergency, I'm a police officer.
Police officer? Well, we'll see what we can do about that. What's the address?
733 Sanford.
What did they say?
They said they'd get a man up here.
Easy with this. You drop that and you get up to their apartment without the elevator.
What if it rings when I'm up there?
Don't worry, it won't. Anyway, we'll cut off the calls from here.
Okay, here goes.
Get out fast.
You're sorry about that Palumbo dame, aren't you?
Not the way you mean.
Suppose you think I gave her raw deals, then.
You should have seen Mrs. Palumbo when she found out you were married. She tried to cover for you.
Have to make with the hearts and the flowers.
It takes two to make with hearts and flowers.
Honey.
You don't want to understand that you used her. You hurt her.
Will you forget about the Palumbo dame? She doesn't mean anything to me, and she doesn't mean anything to you.
That's not what she thinks.
That's right, sister. Never trust a cop.
Janie, look, will you...
Yeah, come on in.
There it is right there.
It's money. It's too bad this show is just getting interesting.
Talking. Try 3904. I thought the trouble was in the line.
No, it's short in the selector circuit.
Oh,
well, go on, say it.
What's the use?
It's taken him a long time.
Yeah, well, he seems long.
It's
Mr. Harris?
Yeah? Everything okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Wait for money. Janie.
Pete, I'm tired.
Okay. All right. So I hurt her feelings. I'm sorry. She'll get over it. The work I'm doing is much more important.
The work you're doing is making a big man of Pete Harris. You don't care about the bookies or anything else.
That's not true.
Jess died because you were bucking for a promotion. And you pushed him.
Just, I didn't push him any harder than I pushed myself.
That must be a great comfort to him now.
What are you trying to say?
There's a big empty place inside of you, Pete. That separates you from other people. Jess cared for you. I love you. Maybe that other woman loves you, too. But we can't reach Pete Harris. You feel alone all the time. When a person feels alone, they can be indifferent. Cruel.
If that's what you really think, maybe you ought to be married to somebody else.
I thought if I loved you enough, maybe you'd learn that other people count.
Janie, you know how I feel about you, don't you? All right, maybe other people don't count, but you do, you do.
Pete, that's no answer.
It's all set.
Going to be so easy.
Look, Norris is breathing down my neck.
Well, I'll do what I can.
Look, Finelli, tell him they already suspended three of my men.
Okay, I'll be in touch.
Thompson and Higgins just followed Wills into the subway.
What about Wills?
I've got a team tailing him.
And Lil Palumbo? How did she find out where I lived?
Lil Palumbo's clean. Her story checks.
Sure she is. Who'd she talk to if she left my place?
She couldn't remember.
I'll make her remember.
Harris, you're going to do things my way. What you learned yesterday could prove that Wills is working for the syndicate. Important lead. We still don't have the kind of evidence we need to close in on them. As long as you're on the force, Harris, you'll take your orders from me.
All right. Maybe I better quit before I can.
Yes? Pete! What do you want? Listen, you. What happened, happened, and I'm sick to death about it. Mr. Norris said that everything...
Last night, after you left my apartment, who did you talk to?
I don't told Mr. Norris I don't remember.
Try a little harder.
I can't.
Now, where did you go?
I went to the bar down the street.
Who with?
Nobody.
Who else was there at the time? Try to remember.
I can't.
Where did you go afterwards?
I came home, I guess.
Alone?
Yes.
How did you get here? Did you drive? Try to remember.
I walked.
Walked?
Yes. Now I remember. I walked. I walked home in my stocking feet. In my stocking feet. I broke the heel of my shoe and Rudy tried to help me.
Rudy?
I'll get my shoe, my shoe.
Rudy, he was there the night that I was arrested on that phony charge. Rudy, Rudy, of course. I must have been blind. Do you know where to get in touch with him?
The Elite Bar. The number's in my book.
If he's not there, you leave your name.
Can't you leave me out of it?
You out of it? If you hadn't opened your mouth, my wife would still be alive. Now get over here and talk.
Hello? Is Rudy there? I can't hear. Just a minute.
My God.
Would you say that again? Would you tell him Lil Palumbo called and wants him to come over as soon as he comes in? Thanks.
What are you gonna do?
I want to talk to him.
And if he's the one, you're going to kill him? You're going to get him here and kill him?
Are you worried about Rudy?
No, I'm worried about a guy named Pete Harris. If you kill him, you're just as bad as he is.
Come on, turn it off.
I can't just turn it on and turn it off.
All right, I was stringing you. You were had. You better get used to the idea.
So I've been taken. I fell for it. What do you want me to do about it?
I'm sorry, Lil. I'm sorry it worked out like this. A lot of things worked out wrong. I'll set one thing right.
Find out what you want to know, but please, please don't kill him.
All right, let him in.
Just a minute.
Nicky, the bar said you wanted to see me.
About last night.
What about it?
The bomb. Mrs. Harris. The district attorney saw me today. You want to know who I talked to? Rudy? Did you have anything to do with it?
Now, what do you want to listen to cops for? Forget about them. Think about yourself. Do yourself some good. Here, look. I'm going to take a vacation. Come with me.
I'm sorry, Rudy.
That cop, huh? Still carrying a torch.
Guess I am.
Don't you know he did a job on you? I didn't hear him tell us. Forget about a little problem. I can just hear him laughing it up with him. Telling her how you made with the hearts and flowers.
How come you know so much about what he said to his wife?
I get around.
A laundry driver?
Forget it.
No. Sound like you know what he said. You did listen, didn't you?
I said forget it. I'm telling
you. Why? Because you've said too much and because I know too much. And if I know too much, you'll have to kill me the way you killed her.
Look, I don't kill anybody. I only take orders.
They'll give you orders to kill me, and you'll kill me.
They don't even need me to do it. Don't you know what this is? This is $1 million. $1 million every week. They get hundreds of runners. The whole city's sewed up. Cops right up to the top. They can squash you like a bug. And me.
Like they squash Gus.
Shut up.
You killed him. You were there and you beat him up.
You listen to me and you listen hard. You shoot off your mouth and what happened to Gus is nothing to what happened to you. You remember that.
Captain Wells, you always get curb service.
Thanks.
Paper, Mr. Edmondson?
Just the race results.
It's a story on page one. Woman was killed.
An accident.
Barney. Johnson, Mrs. Harris. All accidents. Look, I've had it.
Take a walk, Rudy. This is private.
According to my figures, you've taken over $30,000 from us in the past 6 years.
For looking the other way when the bookies came around. Not for murder.
I can see your point.
I can't take any more.
The letter in my pocket. My resignation from the force for reasons of health. I'm turning it over to the commissioner tomorrow.
Tear it up, Wills. We need you right where you are, at the police station. If you resign now, others will panic. We've got an organization we have to keep running.
The DA's on my back. There's an investigation. 3 of my men are on the list.
Now pull yourself together. Nobody's testified against us yet.
I'm through, Edmondson. One way or another, I'm through.
All right, Wills. Let's play table stakes. You are afraid of what the DA will do to you. Well, we have a lot more to lose. That's my hand, Wills. You want to call it? Give me that letter.
There.
Drop it. Get in there.
Harris! You know him?
He's a cop.
That Harris?
Yeah, he was just standing there listening. He was alone.
I'm afraid, Harris, you know too much.
Another accident.
Should I send you back to the DA?
Where does it end?
You ask too many questions. Rudy.
Come on. Well, suppose I can ask for police protection, can I, Captain?
Hold it. Drop it, Rudy. Drop it.
Shots to tell you that story. This is the laundry where it all happened last night. The raid produced the names of dozens of police officers who have been selling protection to the bookies. With the arrest of millionaire boss bookie Ralph Edmondson, District Attorney Norris struck a death blow at the syndicate that has been terrorizing Brooklyn.
I was wondering how you were feeling, Pete.
Oh, I feel fine, thanks.
I came to say goodbye. I won't be around anymore. I'm selling the garage. There's nothing to keep me around here, is there?
I guess not. Good luck. Yeah, well, I'll see you around.
Yeah, sure.
It's a nice day
for Brooklyn.
Welcome back. Oh, hey. Found a spare. Lucky me. Now, was I right or not? Didn't we have some great camera work and light contrast there in those final scenes? I mean, That's the kind of cinematography that you expect to find in a noir. Now, Darren McGavin, and he's the one playing Pete Harris here. He was born in Spokane, Washington, and his real name was William Lyle Richardson. Now, his parents divorced when he was only 11 years old. And this was kind of odd. Custody was awarded to his father, even though his father traveled extensively for work. So the truth is, Darren really grew up with relatives near Tacoma. And he was something of a cantankerous youth. I mean, he even ran away from home a couple times. But he did eventually move in with his mother and stepfather in Galt, California. Now, speaking of cantankerous youth, he was in what is far and away my favorite holiday movie, 1983's A Christmas Story. And I say cantankerous because if you've seen that one, you remember, all Ralphie wants for Christmas is a Daisy Red Ryder BB gun. I'll tell you, I saw that when it first came out in the theaters. It was just before Christmas in 1983. I was in college at the time. And me and a few of my fraternity brothers, we went and saw it at the theater. And we howled the entire time. Now, Darren McGavin, if you remember, he had the role of Ralphie's father, you know, the old man. Oh, I'll tell you, that movie was hysterical. And I identify with it because I got my own Daisy Red Ryder BB gun when I was 9 years old. And I tell you, I loved those scenes. My favorite parts in that movie where he would be cussing, but they would overdub his voice with just a bunch of mumbled gibberish. But, you know, that movie, as much as I love it, that is not my first memory of Darren McGavin. When I was in junior high, he was in a TV series, Kolchak the Night Stalker. It aired on ABC from 1974 to 1975. And he had the title role as Carl Kolchak. He was a reporter for the INS wire service in Chicago. And what the premise of the series was every week, you know, there would be a murder or a series of murders. And they always had a supernatural theme to it. Like once he would go to investigate it, it was some type of monster or ghost or vampire, you know, something supernatural or science fiction, you know, to the conclusion of it. I loved that show. I remember it specifically. It aired on Friday nights, and I would go through the rest of my week just waiting to get to Friday night at 10 o'clock when I could watch The Night Stalker. But you know, that TV series, it was the result of two made-for-TV pilot movies, 1972's The Night Stalker and 1973's The Night Strangler. They just changed the title slightly. Oh, I remember that show. You know, it only aired for one season. I was really disappointed when it ended. But boy, did I love that show. And an interesting thing about that TV series is that is cited as the inspiration and something of a predecessor by the creators of The X-Files. Now, remember, if you like old movies like this, click on the subscribe button. You'll be notified of future releases up here in the notification bell. And you can just type Full Moon Matinee in the search bar or click on the Full Moon Matinee icon down here and you can find all of the prior releases. And as always, I thank you. for spending the evening with Full Moon Matinee. Stay with us as we continue our further investigations into the long-lost evidence of Hollywood. Until next time.